Dear students, welcome to the English class. Yes. Today's session consists of sea reading. The lesson Brave Potter under Unit 2. And the theme of the lesson is wit and humor. The unit theme of the unit is wit and humor. This was written by Margaret Seek. Let's know about the author. Margaret Seek was a great storyteller. He was very much interested in telling folk and mythological stories of Asia. He traveled across many Asian countries and collected interesting short stories from various countries and published them in English. He translated many famous Indian folk stories into English. The present short story, The Brave Potter, is a very popular Telugu one collected by him from India. Let's understand the glossary. Blinding, which means very bright. Thatched, covered with dried straw. You can look at the pictures. Nod off, fall asleep. Palm wine, toddy or fermented palm juice drunk by village folk. You can have a look at the picture of palm tree and extracting toddy from the palm tree. Muttered, spoke something that cannot be heard, speak in a low voice. Your Majesty, that is the way of addressing a king or a queen. Saddle, saddle is a leather seat for a rider on a horse, that is the place where the rider sits. Stirrups, metal rings that hang down on each side of a horse saddle. Use it to support the rider's foot. You can have a look at the pictures about saddle and the stirrups. Pawing. Touching something repeatedly with a paw. Just have a look at this picture where the horse is continuously pawing. Hooves, the hard parts of the feet of some animals like horses. Yes, you can see clearly here. Reins, long leather bands held by a horse rider to control it. Yes, these are the reins these are used by the rider to control it. Crashing, falling. Sentry. Sentry is a word given to a guard or a soldier whose job is to guard something, just like a gatekeeper. So in this lesson, he is a sentry at the king's palace. Uprooted. Pulled a tree or a plant out of the ground with the roots. Cheering crowd. A large gathering of people shouting in joy. The title of the story is The Brave Potter. Now we'll start with the introduction part of this Brave Potter story. Generally these are termed as folk tales, as these are famous in the villages. Stories that are famous in villages are called as folk tales. Yes, here is the potter, who is a simple living person who was timid actually, transforms into a brave potter without his knowledge due to a series of situations. Margaret Sieg has chosen a very well-known Indian folk tale for retelling in English. Children and adults alike are fond of folk tales, which are often amusing and sometimes instructive. Children, here some words are highlighted. You need to focus on the words given over there, highlighted words. I already told you folk tale is nothing but the story that is famous in the villages. And fond of is interested or liked. Amusing, which entertains. Instructive, that is informative. Some stories are entertaining, some are informative. It was dark. Thick black clouds covered the evening sky. The thunder roared and the strong wind shook the branches and leaves of the trees in the forest. Pit, pat, pit. Drops of rain fell. Then the lightning flashed and split the black sky with its blinding light. Soon it was raining heavily. An old tiger ran through the rain looking for shelter. He was wet and cold and his cave was far away. While hurrying to his shelter, he saw an old hut. With a sigh of relief, the tiger crawled under the thatched roof and lay down by the door. Except for the sound of the rain, all was quiet. Before he could nod off, however, he heard something heavy being dragged inside the hut. This was followed by the voice of a woman. Children, you need to understand the opening scene of the story. So in the first para, the author described about the stormy night and the rain and how an old tiger, he missed his way to the cave and saw a hut nearby and relaxed over there. But suddenly he happened to hear a loud noise or the voice made by a woman. "Oh, how terrible this leak is," she complained. "How terrible? I would rather meet a tiger in the forest than have this leak in my house." She compared her house. She says, "How terrible this leak is." The hut was leaking. So the leak was so damaging, she felt it to be better to meet the tiger in the forest than having this leak in her hut. "A leak?" the tiger thought. "What is a leak? It must be very dangerous and strong, or the woman would not be more frightened of the leak than of me. Am I not rightly called the king of the forest? Aren't they all afraid of me? I wonder what a leak looks like." So tiger got a doubt what it could be, what a leak could be. So he thought it might be more dangerous than the tiger. So it got frightened. Soon afterwards, the tired tiger fell asleep. He was suddenly awakened by an angry voice shouting in his ear. He felt heavy blows fall upon his head and shoulders. That means somebody came and hitting him hardly. He woke up with that angry voice. "You horrible beast," a voice screamed angrily. "How dare you run away? How dare you make me walk about in the middle of the night trying to find you? Be careful. One of these days, I'll kill you. Now, go home." So that creature is warning the tiger. The old tiger shivered. On hearing the above words, the old tiger got shivered. This must be the leak who has come out of the hut. And it also thought that this must be the leak that has come out of the hut. "I would rather do as he says, or he will kill me." So he just obeyed the creature which was hitting him. So the tiger allowed him to be bound around the neck with a thick rope. The mysterious creature then climbed onto the tiger's back and pulled at the rope. "Come on, head for home," shouted the voice. The tiger felt a sharp kick on his side. The tiger was terrified and he ran through the dark forest. The creature pulled hard on the rope to tell him which way to go. At the same time, it scolded, cursed, and kicked the poor tiger. Soon they stopped in front of a small hut on the edge of the thick forest. The creature climbed down from the tiger's back and bound him with an iron chain to a nearby tree. Then he went inside the hut. The tiger could not free himself from the chain, so he had to spend a miserable night under the tree. Who was this creature who was able to capture such a large and dangerous tiger? Let's find out. Children, look here. There's a picture of a village. That is a potter's house. And a donkey tied to the palm tree. He had a donkey. On that afternoon of the day, so this is the second scene of the story where you will get to know about the story of the tiger, why it was taken by the creature. Here the creature is nothing but the potter. So this lesson is written in a very simple language. It is easy to understand. Just follow the lines and try to understand. On the afternoon of the day, a potter had arrived home after a hard day's work. He was tired and thirsty. He had asked his wife for some palm wine. The more he drank, the better he felt. When he had drunk all the wine, he no longer felt tired. When the storm began, the potter suddenly remembered that he had left his donkey tied under a tree. He rushed out of his hut to take the animal into the stable. Stable is the place where the animals are kept. You can imagine his anger when he discovered that the donkey was not there anymore. The only thing left was its chain. That means the donkey had fled away. "My stupid donkey must have run off into the forest," he grumbled. "When I catch him, I'll give him a good beating." The potter walked through the wet forest. When it became dark, he often stumbled over roots and fallen branches in the forest. With each step, the potter felt angrier and angrier with his donkey. "When I catch him, I'll tie him up under the tree all night," he muttered to himself. Hours later, the potter reached the old woman's hut. There he saw an animal sleeping in front of the door. Just recollect the picture that you have seen in the first introduction part, where a tiger was sitting in front of the house. So here, hours later, the potter reached the old woman's hut where he was trying to search this donkey. He saw an animal sleeping in front of the door. "There he is," he shouted. Here the "he" refers to the tiger. So when he found the tiger, he thought that it as his donkey. "There he is," he shouted. "There he is, the stupid animal." The drunken potter did not notice the difference between the donkey and a tiger. He kicked and beat the sleeping tiger. He then jumped onto the frightened animal's back, rode it home, and then tied it up with the iron chain. Past tense of ride is rode. Look at the picture. The drunken potter, thinking that it has his donkey, he tied the chain. He tied the tiger with the chain and going back to his home. Next morning, the villagers who passed the potter's house looked in amazement at the tiger tied to the tree. Soon the news spread throughout the village that the potter had caught a tiger and tied it to a tree in his yard. All the villagers praised his courage. They also thanked him because the tiger had eaten many of their goats and buffaloes. They had tried to catch him for many years but had failed. Of course, the potter said that he had done nothing of the sort. Sort here means not of that type. He had said that he had only brought his donkey home. He did not understand how a donkey could change into a tiger. When he saw the tiger, he fainted. He fell unconscious. See, look here how the villagers, they were looking in amazement after seeing the tiger near the potter's house. Nobody, however, believed the potter's story. The villagers even praised him for being modest. Soon the potter became famous. Everybody who met him called him the brave potter. The simple potter himself never understood why. So this is the next part of the story. A few years later, war broke out between the potter's country and a much stronger neighbor. The king immediately gathered a large army, but he realized that it was not strong enough to save his country from defeat. He needed a hero to lead his army. Where could he find such a brave man? The king hurriedly called his ministers together and asked their advice. One of the ministers remembered the story of the brave potter. "Your Majesty," the minister said, "I know someone who can lead our army." He gave advice saying that he knew some potter who became famous for catching the tiger and tying it at his hut. The king immediately sent a messenger to the potter's house. When the potter realized that he had been made general of the army, he became frightened. The king had ordered him to go to the palace the next day. How could he, a poor, ignorant potter, become the general of the army? He had never carried a sword, nor had he ever ridden a horse. "Oh, I shall die because of that stupid donkey," groaned the potter to his wife. "He has only brought us trouble." Because here the potter, who is a very simple man, is not aware of anything like carrying a sword or riding a horse. So he got frightened. The next day he went with his wife to the capital. The king was pleased to see him and ordered the potter to lead the army into battle the next day. The enemy were not far from the gates of the city. A splendid house had been prepared for the potter and his wife. Splendid is nothing but grand. The horse which would carry him into the battle was ready in the stable. That night the potter couldn't sleep. He was nervous and worried because he did not know how to ride a horse. "If I fall off, everybody will laugh at me," he thought. "I will get up very early tomorrow and practice riding the horse." At dawn, dawn means the sunrise, the time of sunrise, early morning. At dawn, the potter woke up his wife and they went to the stable. They saw the beautiful brown horse ready for its new master. "Oh, how tall he is," sighed the potter. "I shall never be able to climb onto his back." "Put this bench beside him," said his wife, "and use it as a step." Even with the help of the bench, the potter had much difficulty climbing onto the horse's back. When he was finally seated, he found that the saddle was very slippery. "Please tie my feet to the stirrups, dear wife," said the potter. "Otherwise, I shall certainly fall off." His wife found some rope and bound her husband's feet tightly to the stirrups. She then passed the rope underneath the horse and tied the two stirrups together. She also passed a length of rope around the potter's waist and tied him to the saddle. So they were preparing hard to ride the horse. "Now please tie my hands to his neck," said the potter. Meanwhile, the big brown horse was impatiently pawing his hooves on the ground. When the potter's wife tried to pass another rope around its neck, the horse suddenly jumped free. It got irritated for so much of preparation by the rider. So it galloped out of the stable with the potter hanging like a sack of rice on its back. Only the ropes kept him from crashing to the ground. The potter held tightly to the horse's neck and prayed to all the gods to save his life. After galloping through the quiet streets, the horse crashed through the city gates and raced across the open fields. It leapt over the fences and streams and began to head for the enemy's camp. When the potter realized where they were going, he tried harder than ever to stop the horse. He pulled wildly on the reins, but it was of no use. The horse galloped on. So the rider became tensed. When they passed a young tree, the potter grabbed a branch, but the horse did not stop. Instead, the tree was pulled out of the ground. A sentry from the enemy camp saw the potter galloping towards the camp with the tree in one hand and his reins in the other. "That must be the general who captured a tiger with his bare hands," he thought. "Now he has uprooted a tree with only one hand. He's not an ordinary man. He's a giant. Run, run, save yourselves. The famous tiger general is coming at the head of a large army to attack us. He has the strength of a giant. He has uprooted a tree with one hand." So this sentry alarmed the whole enemy camp about the entry of this brave potter. The frightened soldiers fled. Their king was left by himself in his tent. Hurriedly, he wrote a letter begging for peace and apologizing for attacking the country. He felt sorry, so he wrote a letter for peace, begging for peace. He left this letter in the tent. Then he jumped on his horse and followed his soldiers. When the potter's brown horse reached the deserted camp, it stopped. There were no men in the camp, so it is termed as deserted camp. It stopped. With shaking hands, the potter untied his feet and fell to the ground. Opposite of tie is untie. When he looked around, he was surprised to find the camp empty. He looked in the king's tent and found the letter. The puzzled potter walked back to the city with the letter in his pocket. He went to his wife and gave her the letter. After reaching home, he said, "Dear wife, never in my life will I ride a horse again. Please take this letter to our king and tell him that the enemy has run away. I am going to bed." His wife ran towards the palace with the letter. When the king read the letter, he was full of praise for his new general. He asked the potter's wife where her husband was. "My husband is tired. Your Majesty, the servants have put him to bed," answered the wife respectfully. "Let him rest today. Tell him to come tomorrow to receive his reward," the king said. Next morning, the potter went to the king's palace. He left the brown horse in the stable and walked to the palace with his wife. The streets were filled with cheering crowds. They all heard about his brave action. "Look how humble he is," they said to each other. Humble means modest, without any pride. Any other man would ride to the palace on a horse, but he is walking like an ordinary man. He is truly a humble and brave man. The king rewarded the potter so well that he did not need to work again. The country was peaceful for the rest of his life, and the potter never rode a horse again. Children, hope you enjoyed the story. Read once again. So, for the better understanding. Children, thank you. And please go through the worksheet slot for the comprehension part and also attempt the online test. Thank you. Happy learning.